Hello, everyone. Welcome. Today we're going to read out of the book of Acts, Acts chapter 1. And we'll read several verses of scripture, so just kind of bear with me as I read. Acts chapter 1. The former treaties have I made, O Theophilus, all that Jesus began both to do and to teach unto the day in which he was taken up, after that he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passions by many infallible proofs, being seen of them for 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. He saith, ye have heard of me, for John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. And when they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father has put in his own power. But you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witness unto me both in Jerusalem and Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost parts of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand you gazing into the heavens? The same Jesus whom was taken up from you in heaven shall also come in like manner as you have seen him go into heaven. Then I want to jump down to verse 14, and it says this, that all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women, the mother of Jesus, Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brethren. And in those days, Peter stood up in the midst of his disciples and saith, the number of names together were about 120. Father, I thank you for the reading of your word. I pray no injustice to your word, nor unto anyone who listens to this today or tonight. Father, Lord, I pray, God, you anoint me, God, to speak what you placed in my spirit, and God will give you the praise, honor, and glory. In Jesus' name, let somebody say, amen. Amen. After the crucifixion, Jesus appears to his disciples for 40 days, strengthening their faith, reassuring them that he has power over death and over the grave. He spoke things pertaining to the kingdom of God and the promises of God that would come. He commanded that they wait for the promise of the Father, reminding them that the Comforter would come, dwelling with them and in them. You can find that in John 14, verse 17. He promised that they would be endued with power or clothed with power from on high. You can find that in Luke 24:49. His command to wait was to enable them to receive power. That is, his power would empower them to be what they needed to be, his witnesses, the ones who validate his truth. I believe we are the ones who show the reality of who God is, not by our own mind or by our own spirit, but by his spirit and by his mind. I believe it's time, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for us as believers to be empowered. Therefore, we can empower others to believe. Let's look at our first principal point here today. The scripture says in verse 4 that it is time to receive the promise. Well, what do you mean the scripture says that? Well, the scripture says this in verse 4. Actually, we could jump back to verse 2 where it says the Holy Ghost, where he came and he was speaking through the Holy Ghost and had given commandments unto them, unto the apostles whom he had chosen. And then we find in verse 4, the scripture that I was actually really wanting to focus in, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. The important note in that verse of scripture to me is in verse 4 is that he commanded them. He commanded them. Commanded them. I understand that not everyone sees things like I do, and that is perfectly fine. And that's why we all live in this great nation of America. We can all have our own opinion. But the Bible is the Bible, and the Word of God says that Jesus commanded him. So to me, it was not optional for his disciples. It was not optional for those 120. He said, you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Not should be, but you shall be. Not could be, but you shall be. If we look into this just a little bit deeper, look at Acts chapter 2 here. It says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house wherein they were sitting. So the whole house is full of the power of God. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire that set on each of them. So there appeared forked tongues like fire that came in, and the fire of God. And so in other words, there was a external presence in the house. But he just did not leave it to the external presence. Because then it goes on down to verse 4 and it says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Then they were all filled. So out of the 120 in that upper room, how many were filled with the Holy Ghost? Can I tell you the answer to that question? Is they all were. Every single one of them was filled with the Holy Ghost. Why is that important? Because God does not want to leave anyone out. See, this mission is too big, and it is too amazing, and it is too great for just a few. Ladies and gentlemen, we need the many. We need everyone. We need everybody to be filled with the power and the presence of God, that we may be able to do everything God has called us to do. It is time that we receive the promise. Well, how do you know it's for everyone, Pastor Matt? Well, you don't base a doctrine on one scripture, do you? No, you got to go to another scripture. So let's look here in Acts chapter 2, down in verse 38. This is when we'll read on up a little bit. Where the men says in verse 37, well, Peter's up there preaching on the day of Pentecost, and the men ask him, as the presence of God is so strong and it pricks their hearts, and says, what shall we do? Then Peter says, repent, be baptized, everyone, in the name of Jesus Christ for remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And he goes on to say this. This is the focus I want to talk about. For this promise is unto you and your children and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord thy God shall call. So the promise is not just for a certain few, but it's for all. The commandment was just not for a few, but it was for all. Let's look on over in the portion of scripture in the book of Acts. I mean, let's just flip through this for just a little bit. We've got plenty of time. The scripture says that after Peter and John healed the lame man, that they went through the trial, and they were threatened and they were beaten for preaching in the name of Jesus, and they were forbidden to preach in that name again. He says that they gathered together, and they come together, and they begin to pray. There's something about when Christians pray. We'll get to that in a second, though. And when they had, verse 31 of Acts chapter 4 says this, and when they had prayed, the place was shaken. So another external presence, another external moving took place. Something was happening in the atmosphere. Something was happening in the building. The building was shaken where they assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and spake the word of God with boldness. So again, they were all. Is that with me? All, not just one, two, three, four, but they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. We could go to Cornelius's house, find the same principle. But I want us to go to a little bit on past all of that and go to Acts 19, where the disciples of John were there. And Paul comes to them and says, have you received since you believed? And they said, what are you even talking about? We've not even heard about this Holy Ghost. We've only been baptized under John's baptism. So the scripture says that Paul begins to preach unto them the name of Jesus and to declare Jesus. John came declaring Jesus, and Jesus showed up. Somebody shout hallelujah. And when Jesus showed up, Paul begins to explain to these disciples what it is that they are missing. And so as he begins to declare the word of God and begins to declare Jesus, the scripture says that they begin to open their heart and begin to receive Jesus in their heart. Verse 5 says, and when they had heard this, they were all baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. So they were all baptized, And the scripture says, and when Paul laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spake with tongues and prophesied. Now, you may not find this next portion that I want to talk to you about, but I find this fascinating. Because in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, 39, 40, there are about 3,000 people saved. But in this portion of scripture, there's only 12 men. Verse 7 says this, and all the men were about 12. So it doesn't matter if it's multitudes or if it doesn't matter if it's few. It doesn't matter if it's many or if it doesn't matter if it's one. When Jesus says it's time that we receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, ladies and gentlemen, what he is saying that it is essential for our growth. It is essential for us to become everything God wants us to be. If you want to be everything God wants you to be, it must be Christ in you, for he's the hope of glory. It's the second point I want to talk about. It says first.